Daredevil. Daredevil now has moved to Disney Plus. It moved from there from Netflix. So, you know, all the crop of Marvel Netflix shows like Daredevil, Jessica Jones, all those kind of moved to Disney Plus. So they ended their
relationship. Luke Cage, Punisher, and that's it. There's no other Netflix shows.
Yeah, they made no other television shows.
Yeah, it's no, nothing crazy. Involving martial artists or anything like that. No. Yeah.
Absolutely.
And they kept the violence in the show. So that's a lot of people, what they were wondering when a lot of the show, when the shows kind of crossed over. Because you'll see it. I mean, I was watching the series and they kept in when Kingpin decapitated somebody with a car, then all the blood. Yeah, and...
So good. So good.
Whoa. So can you, Josh, would you be also, if you're able, to kind of give like the boring adult background on how they were, I mean, I know they were able to acquire them because technically they are projects, but again, yes. Like how you said,
yes, so back in the day when they were in development, they were originally made by Marvel Studios. The whole idea was that all of these Netflix shows were going to be set within the MCU, and eventually they would cross over with characters like Captain America, like Iron Man. But, you know, as time went on and Iron Fist fucked up the whole thing for them, they decided to just retcon all of it and just say that, you know what, Netflix, you guys, you do your thing. Just keep that fucking white boy away from us.
Yeah.
But as a couple years went by, then the rights, the broadcasting rights to the shows with Netflix expired. So that was when... Disney acquired them back. Disney acquired the character rights back for all of them, and then they just slowly started to shift away, cancel all the shows, and then whenever Disney Plus was up and running, that's when they decided to move everything over, and that's when they updated the parental controls. So that's why they have like a TVMA option on there now,
which rules, by the way.
Yeah.
So
which is why I can watch shit like Pam and Tommy and Fresh on my Disney Plus here in Japan.
Yeah. Or you can watch Luke Cage dick down Jessica Jones.
you want to see Jessica Jones get railed.
Yeah. Like great job Netflix. You guys doing the Lord's work. But so good.
Wait, I'm gonna to Disney this. Jesus Christ! Over here, got the fucking BBC, fucking. No, but I guess we can kind of get excited for Blade, maybe, because now they can kind of release R-rated films if they want. It'll just
be Yeah, and even shows like Moon Knight with shows like Falcon and the Winter Soldier and Moon Knight, the subject matter, it's much darker than anything I think the MCU tackled up to that point. And I think with the timing of it, with them finally dropping all of the Netflix shows and then rolling right into Moon Knight, I think they're kind of getting the reaction of, okay, can we do darker, more violent stuff, especially when we've already announced characters like Blade coming to the MCU.
So I think we've been heading this direction for a while, honestly, because even if you go back to Winter Soldier, that was kind of the start of it, because it's like, oh, we're going to talk about, you know, secret government surveillance, you know, inside a fucking superhero film. And like, so the subject matter has slowly, you know, like they've been at, you know, adding more thriller kind of horror elements to their stuff as well. Like really since like Infinity War. So like, we've been kind of heading this direction, in general, but, I think they already confirmed Blade is still going to be PG-13, but even watching, something like Moon Knight, or even Hawkeye, like they're showing people get shot in the chest with fucking arrows in Hawkeye with no gumption of like, oh well, you know, that wouldn't kill you. So like they are, and the kills in Moon Knight are fucking brutal, which is something I actually dig about the show, which, you know, shows you don't always need to show blood to get across violence. So I think you're gonna get something violence-wise in the vein of something like Moon Knight with Blade. Like, I think they'll push that PG-13 line as far as they possibly can.
I'd imagine you get action similar to something like in the Batman, where it's the stunt work and the sound design that you feel like the crunch of someone's face getting bashed in.
Everything doesn't, like, I know people want everything to be rated R, and it's like, you don't always need, it doesn't always need to be. Like, now, do I think something like The Punisher would be harder to pull off in PG-13? Yeah. But do I think you could do it? Yeah, probably, actually, you know? I mean, you know, we don't have to Alec Baldwin everything, you know? We can have things be less violent.
Rated R films are more, though, than just sex and cursing. I mean, they've been pushing that line with action films since the fucking 80s. But I feel like with Disney, my issue is that I want them to go rated R just because I feel like it would force them to change their formula. It would force them to not try to break every scene up with a fucking comedic, you know what I mean? Like, throw in. It would force them to actually say racism. You know what I mean? Like, it would force them to actually, like, give us something of actual substance versus, like, this kind of, we're going to teeter the line. It's like, girl, you've been teetering the line. But I don't understand. You have kids movies where they killed the mother and the little bear, we had to figure it out. You have Lion King where we saw that nigga daddy thrown off a cliff. Just knock it off, okay? Like, y'all can go there. Please go there.
I mean, they did with something like Falcon and the Winter Soldier, though. Like, I mean, you, like, so here's the thing. There's a difference between not going there and people not wanting to accept what you put out there, because the whole concept of connecting the Tuskegee experiments to Falcon Winter Soldier, which is clearly their version of it, and people going like, oh, I don't want to accept this, because there's a lot of that from people who reviewed the show, even like critics were kind of like, I don't want to address that. It's like, okay, well, if you want these things to get real, you're going to kind of have to accept, you know, like, whether it makes you uncomfortable or not. I mean, fuck, Jessica Jones is about sexual assault, and people are like, oh, I don't want to talk about it. It's like, well, you can't be mad when these shows introduce real world themes. You just brush past it, you know. That gives them less incentive to do it. They've gone there, but
yeah,
I get what you're saying.
Yeah. Oh, Chill's in the chat right now. He's saying, there's talks in casting Juicy Smollett as the new Punisher, just to shake some shit up. Yeah, Mufasa died from a stroke as he fell in the Blu-ray version.
You know what? You remember in E.T. when they re-released it, though, and they took all the guns out? And they made them like walkie-talkies with the government? I was like, yes, because no one with a badge would shoot a child. It's like, come on, y'all. Really? Walkie-talkies? Like, fuck off. It would have shot those kids.
Yeah. Of course they wouldn't have. Yeah. They were white.
Yeah, you know what? Fair point, actually.
To get into Daredevil, as I was talking about here. Daredevil, like I said, the series is now on Disney+, dealing with the Devil from Hell's Kitchen, starring Charlie Cox, Deborah Ann Wolfe, Vincent D'Onofrio, who Charlie Cox now is officially part of the MCU now. He just showed up in No Way Home. So congratulations to that character. And I remember there was an interview, Jessica Hegwick, she did with somebody where they were talking to her about it and talking about her character. And she said, like, I think Charlie Cox had told her that when Daredevil ended, when they canceled the show, Marvel had told him that, don't worry, your character's going to be coming back. So, you know, don't worry about it. And that's the reason why she turned down a Marvel role, because I think she was supposed to be in Shang-Chi, but she turned that down. She said she was hoping for the same thing to happen to her, where her character would come back in some capacity. But I don't know why you would think that, you're not Daredevil, but whatever. So that was kind of
they told her.
she was also one of the more genuinely liked characters out of out of that universe. I mean, she was basically the star of Iron Fist.
True.
There's no basically. She was the star of Iron Fist. Let's call it.
She was the one person that. She was the one person in the entire production of that show that actually gave a shit.
And she eventually even became Iron Fist. She took his own show from him, but yeah.
Nothing of value was lost.
So you kind of see that a little bit. You know, he's back, and also Vincent D'Onofrio is Kingpin, who a lot of people loved both those characters there. You know, for the character he showed up in Hawkeye recently.
Back when the shows were airing, it was almost a crime that neither Cox nor D'Onofrio got any like awards recognition because those are both Emmy worthy performances in both of these, at least in the first and third seasons of the show.
So like season two is a step down, but it's still a damn great show. It has the
Iron Man 2 problem where it's so preoccupied with setting up the Defenders that it kind of forgets to be a show about Daredevil.
Are we talking about the whole show, by the way?
Season 1, 2, 3?
Cool. I just want to make sure before we got into spoilers. So the thing about season two is, okay, so like season one I would give like an A+2. I think it's a brilliant episode season of television. Season two is like an A-, and the reason why it's an A- is because they can't figure out how to make the hand work, and it's so goddamn frustrating that you make immortal fucking ninjas boring, and it's like, fuck, why is this so hard for you to get across? It's really terrible, but everything else in season two. Especially John Bernthal's Punisher, who is just horrifying in the way he just shoots people in the face with no gumption.
That turn as the Punisher is the best version of that character. And I'm somebody that likes at least the first season of the Punisher, but it doesn't hold a candle to his performance in the first four episodes.
His performance in Daredevil is still the best. I dig both seasons of The Punisher because, honestly, Frank Castle is at his most interesting when they get into the war aspects and, like, the fucked up veteran aspect of the character. Mm-hmm. When they get away from that is where the character gets into trouble because they just don't know how to emotionally develop him without that key component. Mm-hmm. And so that's why season two hits with me. Season two of Daredevil, though, when he's just talking about his kids, it's the most heartbreaking goddamn thing. And it's like, oh, wow, that just broke you beyond a point that you can even come back from. And it really, that conversation him and Matt have, or Daredevil have on the roof, which is straight from the comics, is one of the best scenes the MCU's done, like, period. It's just... because you get where Frank is coming from, because he's seen enough people just, you know, get away with shit, you know. And also in the age of us holding cops accountable, that scene is aged, like, hilariously well. It's like, oh, it's like, yeah, you can't just go around killing people, but and that's maybe the best thing in the whole show, or first season, too. But Bernthal is horrifying. He really shouldn't have gotten some awards love for that turn in Daredevil, because he's great in that.
I think I feel that way with season two. Really good season, and you know, we had all seen the show before, all three seasons, just revisiting. And now, Jenna, you watched all three seasons of Daredevil before, right?
Yes, and I'm just now realizing the links between Daredevil and Hawkeye, even though that was one of the greatest shows. I'm starting to see the connections here. I did see all three seasons. I actually don't remember. I had to reread. I was like, what the hell was season two about again? And then because I did not remember. But that was with the Punisher. And to me, season two is actually my favorite season out of all of them. Season one, to me, was boring. I hated it. But the only reason why I stayed was because I believe her name is Karen and Froggy, like the side characters. and running the firm, to me, those dynamics just kind of kept me watching it, because the character of Daredevil himself had to grow on me. He was just not, I just couldn't relate. Like, it just was a complete disconnect. But as the seasons progressed, he grew on me. Even though he's still kind of like a whiny little bitch, but he grew on me, you know what I mean? He gets on my nerves, especially when his bae mama come back in season two. I like season two because it really, I was like, I hope they flesh out this character and like give us something a little bit, like a little bit more depth and a reason why he is the way he is, his character arc, because him being blind and just like that being his whole MO just wasn't, it wasn't giving what it's supposed to give. But in season two, you kind of get more of his background, more
if,
why
if he's... that's your interpretation of season one, they literally spend half of each episode as flashbacks of him growing up and why Matt chose to do the things he did. And there's an episode in season one where it's just Matt and Foggy having a conversation of the why he does this. And it's one of the most heartbreaking episodes of TV I've seen.
And being blind would kind of piss you off just in general. Like, I mean, you kind of just brush by that. Like, oh, him being blind, that's his whole deal. It's like, yes, because that wouldn't make your life...
He's blind, his father's dead, he grew up in a Catholic orphanage.
Oh, blah, blah, blah. Like, I mean, don't know.
Why? You're literally brushing past?
That's a testament, but that's what I'm saying, though. Like, the actor himself, it's more about his acting choices versus, like, the way the character is written. Like, I got the assignment, but to me in season one, it just wasn't emotionally connecting for me. Like, I just didn't feel... I don't know. It just... He just... Like, I got it, but it was... I don't know what was missing. In season one, I think it was also, like, the pacing. I just did not like season one. Like, for me, I really wasn't looking forward to a second season. But then I was glad that I stuck with it even until the third season. But again, it was really the side characters in the show that kind of elevated. Because had it just relied on him, I think he... You know what my issue is with him? He gives me the Keanu Reeves syndrome where you're kind of emoting, like, of course he's blind. But it's like, girl, it's called acting. But it's like, you could, like, his just expressions are just... very flat. Like, he was just like a flat actor, and he was charming at moments, but to me he just wasn't, like, I wouldn't have cast him to be Daredevil. There's, I mean, Ben Affleck wasn't no better, but you know, I wouldn't have cast either one of those little pasty white boys. Season two and season three, again, I think the change in writing and just putting Daredevil in these very on your feet, kind of like, no, you can't go by these models that you spent a whole season whining about. Like, we get it, girl. We know why you're doing it. Like, he couldn't rely on that. Like, it forced him to change. And in forcing that character to change and confront a whole bunch of things, like, on your feet, it was interesting because it was like, finally, we're getting a little conflict. We're getting something. We're getting more from you. And even his acting choices, I think as it went on, he just got better. So I enjoyed him and his character even better. But I did like Elektra. I loved it. And then, of course, season three with Kingpin. Like how you said, like, that's an actor, guys. That's a goddamn actor, okay? Because whenever he was on screen, he fucking killed it. He could have played that character. I mean, Vincent D'Onofrio is fucking Vincent D'Onofrio.
Right? Yeah, Vincent D'Onofrio is one of the greatest character actors working together. And he you give him a role with meat like how Wilson Fisk is written on this show, where half the time you don't know if he's wrong. Yeah. His methods, yes, but his reasoning are warped, but he's also written sympathetically in a way that you understand, especially in his flashback episode and his connection to Ayelet Zurer, who plays Vanessa Mariana on the show.
Fine ass Vanessa. Yeah, I'm like, yeah. Like, I'd kill for her.
I'd kill the entire Russian mob for her.
Right? And speaking of her, when that flip switches in season three, where she's down to be like mob boss wife,
when you realize her hands dirty. She is down to be Lady Macbeth.
Mm. Yeah, and then you're just like, oh shit, because season three. So Daredevil as a character, at his best, when he's being written, is when
it's something feels in the background. Like there with is, you is something in the background.
Oh yeah, I don't know where the remote is. It's Harley Quinn though, but when Daredevil's being written at his best, it's when Kingpin feels like he's always a step ahead. And season three is that for like 99% of it.
Season three is basically just getting kicked in the balls by Wilson Fisk for like 13 episodes.
Because there is that point where, you know, like being someone who grew up going to church and everything, talking to my partner about it season three, because we watched all three seasons together during lockdown, I was explaining to her, I'm like, I don't know if I disagree with Matt about not killing him, because I'm just like, this motherfucker needs to go. And so when Foggy and Karen are both just like, no, don't kill him, I'm like, maybe you should just this once. But Fisk is just ahead at every goddamn point in season three. When what's his name? The FBI guy, agent. Nadine. Thank you. Because the way he gets caught up in it, you're like, oh fuck, that is just the most unfortunate chain of. Oh, your sister lost her job and she got sick. Oh, now you're trapped, and it's fascinating to see how Fisk, you know, just like grunt, like twist the arm of people like who are at their lowest point in working for him, which is so fucking cruel.
That's what he does so well. And especially when you get the reveal of how deep that corruption with the FBI goes, it's heart-wrenching when it happens. And because it's the character in Nadim, who you spent so long thinking that, hey, he's on the side of good, and it's a guy who's like wrong place, wrong time, and his redemption arc in season three, it's a highlight. It's a character a character arc I didn't see enjoying when I like queued up season three of the show, and he ended up being one of the highlights of the entire series, especially because I think season three, it's all about it is a very loose adaptation of the comic arc Born Again. Yes. But it's about not only a Daredevil realizing why he needs to do this, and why he needs to go out every night, and why he shouldn't kill any of his enemy.
With, you know, the different seasons, you know, they're the show, three seasons that they're doing, and they said that they're potentially going to maybe come back with the show, reboot the show. I don't know exactly what they haven't been very specific about what they're going to do, but another season of Daredevil is going to come. You know, they haven't really been particularly, you know, what they're going to do yet, but another season is going to be coming. Seeing, you know, all these seasons again, season one through season three, it is very kind of interesting to see how, like, you know, first of all, this came out in 2015, and this was the very first one of the Marvel Netflix shows.
When it came out, I skipped classes, just hung out in the library with my laptop and my headphones, and binge watched the entire thing.
Yeah. It was, you know, dropped all at once, and it was something. It was great. I mean, it really surprised a lot of people at that time. It was very different from what Marvel was doing. Typically, even on their ABC shows, like with the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. that was out at the time. So that was also very something different. And with Charlie Cox, who I, you know, think did a very good job as Daredevil. I think he did a terrific job as him. And it's funny that, you know, trivia fact that he was roommates with Andrew Garfield and Robert Pattinson at one time. All three of them were...
Right, so cool.
All three of them ended up being superheroes. Hey, you know, who knows? They all had good acting careers afterwards, so good for them. That was kind of pretty nice, little fun, little trivia. And to see the cast of people like Deborah Ann Wolfe, who plays Karen, the actor who plays Foggy. What's the actor's name who plays Foggy?
Eldon Henson, who plays Foggy.
Yeah, Fulton Reed of the Mighty Ducks. Fuck yeah.
Oh, shit, that was him?
That's him, yeah.
So I thought that was, you know, very good supporting cast here that you have. I mean, you know, that worked really well with the show. Nice change of direction they had with the Karen character, because if you know what the happens to the Karen character in the comics, it's a very different version of what
it's,
they did there.
It's very, it, she gets the Frank Miller.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they set it up so well to think that that's exactly what's going to happen with her.
Mm, yeah. So I very kind of much appreciate what they did there. And with the season one, it reminded me how much I love Wesley. Wesley was great. Wesley was, you know, when his first appearance there, yep. It's like he's the right-hand man of Fisk. And afterwards, I did really miss him. It goes into how, you know, really good he was, and I wish they kept him on a little bit longer. But he was really great. I mean, he did die. I mean, it was kind of his fault. I mean, he was stupid.
Oh, it was so. Oh, it was 100% his fault. Yeah, not kind of his fault. What the,
he was a loaded gun on the table.
He was being a sexist pig and going like, "This bitch won't shoot me," and he fucked around and found out. Like the end. Like,
what are you gonna do? Shoot me?
Yeah, and she, oh man.
She unloads on him.
Yeah, and that scene where she tells Fisk that she did it is one of the most tense scenes I've ever seen in anything. When she flat out goes, "I would have shot him more, but the clip ran out." I remember going, "Oh, yeah. Man, he's about to," like, "he's about to choke the shit out of you." And then, oh, that scene. Fuck, I might watch that scene after this. But yeah, that scene rules.
I'm definitely watching that scene after that. All I was looking at was, "Oh God, is there a car door around? Oh my God, run!"
No, I mean, you do kind of have, you know, a lot of great things with him. Jenna, what were kind of your thoughts? You know, you said season two is one of your favorites. What were kind of your thoughts on season three there?
Season three for me was good. I'm trying to remember why I was not. I guess when I rank all of them, season three and then season one for me. Season three to me was really, really good, but it definitely, if it wasn't for, again, Vince D'Onofrio, suck his dick anymore, I feel like it really would have been, it wouldn't have been as good for me. I think, again, the editing in this got better season, but season three was another season which is kind of just like, I don't know if it's an issue of like different directors each episode, or like, I don't know if that's it, or maybe different writers each, like, it's, I can tell it's not the same person doing it each episode, so they don't all feel coherent. So luckily the storyline is intricate enough but not overly complicated to where I could just follow the storyline, kind of overlook the production issues that to me just kind of made season three just, it was good, but again, I don't know. I will probably have all of these episodes to see. But it was still a solid, like, this, again, is like, this show got better with each season. And season three was the culmination of, I think I enjoyed Daredevil's arc because it was just like, nigga, this is real life. You feel me? Like, not like he didn't know. But season one, he set his little foundation. Season two, shook up his foundation. Season three, completely obliterated it. Because they took the question that Batman and Superman failed at, and they always fail at with Batman, should we kill people, should we not? But they did it in a way where it wasn't and boring and just like no real cost, right? In season three, there was a lot of cost, you know? So I like the way that season three, it, to me, it was the most mature out of the seasons because it had the most at stake, because you were dealing with Fisk. And Fisk, I feel like if Fisk wasn't such a strong adversary, the entire season would have suffered. But yeah, it was pretty good. In fact, I think season three was the highest. I think they rated that the highest rating. Season three, I think, had like the highest out of all seasons. So it was pretty good. I just wish they would kind of keep to kind of the same directors, though, just so that it gives me that cohesion. Like Atlanta is a great example of just like a little flow to it.
Yeah, but even that's not directed by the same guy.
Yeah, they switch up.
But Hero, let me not mess up his. Sorry, my Asian people. Solidarity, y'all. But he ended up being the main person. And his brother and somebody else are like the main people who write it. So they're in the season one, I think season two, yeah, it was a couple of different ones. But then they just stuck with one person. Like season, this recent season is all the same. And you can feel the cohesion in the editing and the pacing and just the way it's shot. Which I hope in season three they'll kind of go that way. But yeah, I think that's what I can remember about season three.
And then so how would the rest of you, how would you rank the seasons here?
Oh, easily season three is one of the best. It for me, season three is one of the best seasons of superhero television of all time. I don't think I don't think the only thing that's come close to it is maybe for me stuff like The Boys, stuff like Watchmen, stuff like mm-hmm. Peacemaker. But I think the just the story that they're telling in season three, bringing back Wilson Fisk, introducing the character of Bullseye, who's played excellently by Wilson Bethel, and yes, how they delve deep into his backstory and make him a literal version of Matt without the support of his church, without his guiding light and his principles yeah. of his religion. And it was such a fascinating thing. Season two, I think, is the weakest season, but even so, I'd still say it's like an A minus. So I go like 3, 1, and 2.
Mm. Yeah,
Hunt.
Nick basically said it all. Like Nick is 1,000% correct. Season three is. I'll go a step further. It's one of my favorite seasons of television. Period. I love season three. So fucking much. The last fight between Daredevil, Dex, and Kingpin is one of my favorite fights I've seen in TV. Like that scene, that it's so well done, and the stakes are so high. And one thing we didn't mention is that Matt loses the suit, and so mm-hmm. he's back in the season one suit for the whole time. So him having, you know, not that protection, that little extra protection, does raise the stakes whenever he gets his shit fucked up. And there's a couple times for Bulls. The office fight scene.
The office fight scene is amazing. And both pretty much all three fight scenes with Dex are this opera of choreography and stakes.
Mm. Yeah.
And it's all a marvel. It's a marvel to watch.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah.
Thank you. Couldn't resist.
But yeah, season three is just, and when Matt could have killed him, and when he flat out goes, "I'll go after your wife," which there are some people going like, "That's so cold that he'd do that." I'm like, he could kill him. Shut the fuck up. So
you realize he was like 3 seconds away from killing him, right?
Yeah. Like, shush. But that's so. But scene is just so well done, and season three is great. Nick is right. Like, I already mentioned it. The hand is so frustrating in season two. It really upsets me.
It's so lame.
It is.
Immortal ninjas boring.
Yeah, I just
have a main producer in Jeff Loeb who hates Asian people, I guess.
Hate that. I like the way that they bring Elektra back in, which by the way, like, I know what you called Matt, you know, like a whiny bitch. Elektra's a fucking bitch. She's manipulative as fuck. He should have stabbed her as soon as he saw her.
But, she's a woman. What do you expect, Hunter? She's a woman.
Yeah, I know, right? Your words.
But this is based on a mostly known Frank Miller comic, so of course she's off.
Yeah, but I mean, but their chemistry, though, they do a great job in that flashback episode where you go, like, fuck, I get it. Like, I get why, like, you keep, you know, you can't quit this bitch.
But, it's that entire flashback, it's basically, like, Sid and Nancy for fucking Matt Murdock.
Mm. Yeah, you're not wrong, but it's really well handled. So my big gripe, you know, the hand, don't like that. And this isn't really fair because it doesn't happen on this show, but one of the things I said I would ding the Defenders for is if they just resurrected Elektra's ass just to kill her again, and that's exactly what they fucking do. And I just went, God damn it, Marvel, why would you do that? Elektra's such a great character. Like, it bothers me. Again, it's not season 2's fault, because she at least gets a cool death in season 2, but God damn it, Defenders. Like, you should have been great, and you're just good. But I digress. And then season 1 is just the hallway fight. That alone makes season 1 great.
That was the moment that changed superhero TV forever. Because even after that, you saw shows like Arrow, shows like The Flash. You started to see them incorporate like one take fights in their series. And it's so cool because I watched that Collider Cruel, like Stuntman React. That is a legit oneer. You know how you have a lot of these a lot of these one takes where you have like these hidden cuts in there. It's simulated. That one was for real.
Yeah, and it's so well handled. Like watching that one in the Luke Cage one where he breaks into the armory. Those are two of my favorite fight scenes in anything. Because, like, the Luke Cage one's fucking badass because you just get to see, you know, a black dude in a hoodie not getting shot and fucking shit up. Like, it's fucking incredible. But the hallway fight is so cool because you see those moments where Matt has to, like, stop for a second to get a breath because, you know, he's not a super soldier or something like that.
And
he
gets tired and he gets his ass kicked a lot, too.
Yeah, it's really cool. So one thing that always does bother me, and this isn't exclusive to Daredevil, but it's just an action trope. I hate when people jump through windows and they're not cut. It bothers me so goddamn much. Like, whenever I see that, it's like, at least your hands. Like, please, for the love of God, like, can you show any damage? But Matt takes so much damage throughout the show. It's like, okay, it like kind of makes me forget about it.
It's like every season has an episode where he's basically just laid up bleeding.
Well, the first time he meets Kingpin face to face after he beats the...
He fucked him up.
Oh, man. Like, that there are beings in the Bible that weren't that biblical. Like, I was like, God damn. Like,
Jesus Kingpin, Christ. Yeah, Jesus didn't have it that rough.
Yeah, right. Like, he fucks Matt's world up. And I remember going like, oh, wow, you're really overmatched. But the first time you guys fight, that's how it should feel. So there's there's a beauty in the violence. In season 2 with Punisher, there's this point where he shoots this guy's face clean off of a shotgun. And I remember I was mid-bong hit. I was like, Jesus Christ. Because like, the show's violent, but they'd never shown it to that level. So season 2 is actually more violent than 1, which is insane.
Yeah, that's the greatest. Like, why it's the greatest.
Like, I had a joke, I'm gonna be good. But the show overall is just, it's one of my favorite shows. It's just so great from all the acting performances. Also, I'm blanking on her name, but Foggy ends up hooking up with Ditzy Cool Blonde from Jessica Jones, which Foggy, great pull, sir. Just you know, tip of the cap. But
yeah.
It is cool. It is cool. Season 3, you see other elements from like Jessica Jones and stuff kind of creep in, and so it's like, oh, okay. But yeah, if you haven't watched Daredevil, watch Daredevil. It's kind of great. Yeah. Oh, and Rosario Dawson's great. Yeah, forgot about her.
Yep. Yeah, Rosario Dawson, yeah, she appeared in the first season, and she would go and appear in the other different Marvel Netflix shows. She was kind of their Agent Coulson, I guess, throughout the shows, the recurring character that you saw. Also, the character of Turk, who's also in here as well.
Oh, yeah, he's played by the wonderful Peter Morgan.
Oh, Rob
Morgan. Turk is so good.
Isn't it Rob Morgan? I think it's Rob Morgan.
Oh, Rob Morgan, yes, sorry.
Yeah, Rob Morgan, who's a great character actor, by the way. He appears in a lot of different stuff. He's a really, really great character actor. Really awesome. And yeah, I mean, I would say the same ranking. I'd say, you know, season three, one and two for me, if I had to rank the seasons. And to see the progression of, like I said, the action sequences, seeing them again, still hold up really well, and see how they kind of even improve a lot of different seasons. Even in season three, where he fights Bullseye, where you see the introduction of that character, I thought was really good. The fight sequences there are very interesting, because his whole ability is he can throw things with accurate precision. So seeing him bounce something off of something else and whack Daredevil in the face was absolutely kind of fun to watch. Also, it's kind of seeing the introduction of a lot of these other kind of different characters, these little minor characters that they introduce here, which was kind of very nice. The character who ends up making his costume, that was very good to see, like, how his costume kind of gets progressively better, how he adds, like, different things there to the full classic costume that we see, and the full classic staff that we see, where it can be retractable and he can swing. That was kind of very nice to see. A lot of people prefer, actually, the original, the OG costume, the all-black costume, as opposed to the red one. Actually, I see a lot of people kind of prefer the black one.
Yeah, because it's more comic accurate, if you want to make that, like, technically, because it's plainer. But mm-hmm. I like the evolution of the red suit, as he, like, to your point, as he starts to modify it. It's like, I don't know, it's very kind of like...
Yeah, the reveal... Yeah, the end of season one, the red suit, that was... The season two one that he wears throughout that and throughout the Defenders, that one was really cool. That one looked really good.
But it feels like a Mark One. That's why I liked the end of season one reveal, because he shouldn't have the classic costume by the end of season one. Like, he should, like Marvel's got toys to sell. They can't give you the full classic costume the first time.
I was kind of expecting him to do like the yellow and red one.
But I get what you're saying, though, because, like, you know, you see the elements where, like, the padding is, like, squared out and all that. But for a, you know, a Mark One, which is exactly what it is, I went, yeah, this totally makes fucking sense. So, but to Nick's point, in season two, when he gets the more, like, all red looking one, it looks really sleek. Like, it makes me excited to see what Pattinson's second bat suit's gonna look like for the Batman 2, because if it takes that sort of leap, it's gonna look really clean. But the evolution of the costume is cool, because you only get three, like one per season, and you don't really three, so it's like it works really well for the character in general. But
that was really nice. Yeah, you know, I think it's, you know, this series, I mean, I still think it's one of the better Marvel Netflix shows, for sure. I think it's probably the best one. The other shows, I mean, Jessica Jones, I think it had a great first season, even comparable with some of the best seasons of Daredevil, but I wasn't a fan of the other couple seasons. Jenna, you didn't like Jessica Jones at all?
I feel the exact same way you do. Like, it was one of those shows that had to grow on me. And it just started irritating me. It should have been on HBO and not on
Netflix. See, I dug all three.
Yeah, I mean, it's cute, you know.
I mean, not the word I'd use for this
guy. I mean, it's like, yeah, but I just wish a different hands. It just deserves a different personally.
Mm, yeah.
What I'll say about the one thing I will say about Jessica Jones, just real quick, the scene in the police station with David Tennant's Kilgrave is one of the most tense fucking scenes. It's so incredibly unnerving. And the way that he acts like he loves her is just so many levels of fucked up. We don't have enough time to get into it. Like, it's
Jessica Jones. The first season of Jessica Jones is fucking incredible. And David Tennant is one of the greatest comic villains of all time. I can never rewatch Doctor Who after seeing that anymore.
Yeah. Get your sonic screwdriver away from her.
You know, he was a fantastic villain. I just think they kind of overdid it by bringing him back, like, in season two and trying to use that character again. I just didn't think it had that same impact as it did season one. And you know, with Daredevil, I think it was great when you first see like smaller characters of the Hand and seeing it like more, you know, in the shadows with Madame Gao, who is like this very mysterious character. I think that was very good. It's just the more and more they keep revealing, and then when it eventually gets to the Defenders, it's just not as good anymore. But I liked it when it was, you know, they had first built it up at first. I thought that was really good. I just think the execution of it was poor with the Hand. But you know, I'm wondering what they're going to do for this new season of Daredevil, how they're going to really work it. Would you rather just...
Bullseye. Bullseye.
Well, they already did.
Bullseye.
Bullseye again? They already did Bullseye. You want Bullseye again?
No, I want Bullseye in the costume. That's what I want. I want, like, Bullseye official. That's the shit I want. Yeah, okay. give me that.
give me Wilson Bethel back as Bullseye. Because he was such a great character in the third season.
Mm. Would you want to see
him... What's his name? Who played him?
It was an actor named Wilson Bethel.
No, I meant in the movie.
Who Colin Farrell?
Oh, Colin Farrell was the guy in the movie.
Yeah.
You didn't like Colin Farrell?
Yeah.
So, fun fact, because Disney, like, owns the character, the X-Men characters now, they could actually talk about Bullseye's skeleton being made of animanium. That would be pretty badass, so... They should do that.
Maybe they'll bring that in. Because like, at the end of season three, it was like he got fucked up by Fisk and then he had to have back surgery. So
he's He gets the Bane backbreaker against a wall.
Yeah. Like so fuck. Oh, man. When Fisk just grabs him, you're like, oh, shit, what are you doing? And just rams him to a wall.
Oh, and then you think it's over, and then you realize, oh shit, him and Matt are still standing.
Yeah,
it's god, that shit's so great.
And I will say, like, one of the characters that didn't really work for me, I think, throughout the series, I think all the casting was really great. I did not like the woman who played Elektra. I thought Elektra was, I did not like the actress who played Elektra, Lodi Young.
Interesting.
I didn't think she
was. I thought the writing and the performance was great. I didn't end up liking what they did with
him.
Yeah, no, that's completely fair.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought the actress was... I just didn't think she was all that strong. If they do it, I don't know. I would hope they would kind of replace her with somebody else. Would you want to see a movie or would you want to see a series?
Show.
Give me a show.
Knock it off. We don't need
it. Give me a show. I want more time with this character. Especially with... a lot of the MCU shows, with like especially Moon Knight, I don't think you could have gotten the character development done in 2 hours.
I agree.
I think you needed more than 6 episodes that we're getting, but I think it's working.
If they wanted to,
got 3 seasons of character. So like,
yeah, you're right. You can have too much character development.
I mean, actually, yeah, to the point where do we...
Okay, were you just complaining about Matt being a whiny bitch and you want a movie?
He is a whiny bitch, so that's why I don't want another show.
That doesn't make sense, because you want him to have more character development, but you want to change the medium.
I was being sarcastic. What I'm saying is that, like, we've already gotten 3 seasons. Technically, with the other shows, especially with Hawkeye, even though it wasn't great, but they're already bringing in Fisk. They're already like bringing in that character and that background, the Yakuza and all that. Like, Marvel has already started dabbling in that universe already, and is already expanding that universe already. And then we just see him in what movie was that? Oh my god,
No Way Home, Spider Man.
No, was it Spider? Yeah. So it's just like. Yeah. Bro, y'all don't give that man his movie, give us 3 movies and call it a day. Like, I don't know. I feel like another season, I would like to see it wrapped up in 4 seasons and then give us a film. But I don't think Daredevil's a strong enough storyline to where we gonna get like 5, 6, 7 seasons out that bitch. Like, yeah, I would like to see them try. I would like to see.
There's plenty of Daredevil that they could draw from to get 6 or 7 seasons.
So, like, yeah, there's plenty of Daredevil books to draw from. There's plenty of character interactions that are open now that he is in the MCU. Like, I want to see him interact with Spider-Man. I want to see him play off of Sam Wilson's Cap. I want to see him go up with Shang-Chi.
I mean, last hand, they already kind of did Born Again, Guardian Devil, Yellow. There's just a couple off the top of my head. Like, they have multiple directions they could take the character.
Marvel, you know how Marvel
and he is coming back for Echo. That show that yes. they're doing with Wakakaka's yes. character.
That's what I'm saying. If they don't work, if it's not working to the universe that Marvel is building, you're not gonna get you're just not going to get what you want to get. Like, it'll probably be great to... I know they have all the stories. A lot of these characters have a shit ton of stories that they cover, but they pick specific story and plot lines because Marvel likes to keep... You know, they have a nice little map and a little tree.
Yeah.
But I just feel like now that they have these properties... And to be honest with you, when was the last time we had a good Daredevil movie? Let's talk about it. We haven't. So,
I mean, they've only made one.
Yeah. They've only made one Daredevil.
Exactly. That was trash. Exactly.
And we get the series, and it's awesome.
Exactly. So, I don't know. I would like to see them give him a movie treatment because it's one of those properties that, like how you said, they only did one. So, it's like, now we get to see kind of it refreshed, you know, and we can kind of reboot it in a way that's an actual reboot because it will now be a part of the Marvel universe that's already built.
Yeah.
So I just don't think I don't think Marvel's going to make that many seasons with that character.
Well, rumors we're getting a fourth season. Rumors we're getting a fourth season shooting at the end of this year. So.
You know what? If you can make the hand cool, how?
I mean, honestly, yeah. I mean, they could do a whole run of Daredevil, a season Daredevil off of Bendis's run. Like they've got some stories they could tell throughout a show. But yeah,
they could probably do 5 seasons. I can guarantee you right now they're going to probably do.
Yeah, I could see them doing maybe 2 more seasons. I see a movie because hey, how's it going there, Doctor Strange? How's it going? First time chat.
6 seasons in a movie.
if they do a movie there, because I mean it would be nice for them to do a movie that's more small scale, you know what I mean? I thought that's what Black Widow was gonna be, but that ended up being overbloated. You know, so more on the ground, street level type stuff, movie wise, instead of being a save the world, because Daredevil's not gonna be saving the world, you know what I mean?
Yeah, Daredevil is not that kind of character.
He's not gonna be
that every character is a Not every character is equipped to be a film, though. And that's the thing. Like, to Nick's point earlier, I don't think you could do a good Moon Knight film unless you make this shit, 6 hours. I'm happy they're going the route they am with making it a show. Yeah. But yeah, not every character warrants a film.
Yeah, you know, so. That's true, yeah. I like what they're doing with the show, with Daredevil. Obviously, it worked great as a show, and that was awesome for them. And I can't wait to see what they do. Like I said, they have a lot to draw from comic book wise that they could do, you know, more material on, because Daredevil is not like a character that was how Jessica Jones was. Well, Jessica Jones, really, she only kind of had, I think, one big book, which was the Alias book, really. That was kind of really it.
Yeah, it was just.
Yeah, so, I would love to see that with a lot of stuff they do with season 4. So that was Daredevil. Let me see what Chill's talking. Chill going crazy in this chat. Let me see what he's talking about. Hold on, catch up.
Bring in Matt defending police killing season 5.
Chill, he called Nurse Coulson. Swap meet costume. None of the defenders can dress. Defenders make the Eternals look like Prince in the Revolution.
Fucking weak.
Jessica Jones never changed them.
Damn jeans.
That is true. She did wear the same jeans for 3 seasons. That is very true. Them same ripped jeans.
And she was also an alcoholic.
Yeah.
Alcoholic. Yeah.
I wonder how many times she pissed herself in them jeans, honestly. more Foggy next season.
Foggy's great.
Charlie acting like that in Boardwalk Empire. Yeah, Charlie Cox, that was the first thing I ever saw him in, Boardwalk Empire.
I remember him from that movie Theory of Everything and Stardust.
That's right, he was in Stardust. Forgot about that.
Let's see. Chill. So, Turtles had 3 films, and they are Daredevil's acid sperm. Okay. Loki was the best thing out of the MCU so far. I guess the Loki TV show. I think WandaVision is still the best Disney Plus show. I think still WandaVision.
Interesting. So look, Marvel has let me down once, and that's with Thor: Dark World. Like that's the one time I. Iron Fist, if you want to count that. But yeah, for the most part, I think they hit more than they miss. For me, so far in this new phase, I just think Falcon Winter Soldier is just the shit. I think that show is. It's basically the way I wanted start to finish, but everything else from there has still, I think, been pretty good. I do think it's funny that Marvel's going on this, like, let's talk about religion and, like, but, like, not specifically talk about religion, because, like, Daredevil Season 3 is a man having a crisis of faith. And the thing is, when Matt is talking about why he kind of hates being a Catholic, you're kind of like, he's not wrong for being kind of like, why the fuck should I even give a shit? It's like, I mean, yeah, fair, church is kind of rough, but then he, you know, he finds faith in his own way. Eternals is flat out like, man, you know.
Let's kill God.
Yeah, like, man, God kind of sucks, am I right? But, man, yeah. This whole test of God's, he's kind of mean. Like, it's like, oh, wow, you're going to do this for... Oh, over 2 hours. Okay. But that's basically what that movie is. So I wonder if you need to kind of go back into Matt's faith. I don't think you need to. I think you kind of did that with Season 3. But I think that's kind of a core component of the character that kind of needs to almost be on the back burner. But you don't always have to bring it up.
Well, you also have the question, because this version of the character... who is like a devout Catholic, how does he reconcile with beings like Thanos who at the drop of a hat can snap away half the universe? How does he reconcile knowing that like alien space magic and actual magic exists?
Can we also talk about real quick how the best depiction of the rapture happened in an Avengers film? like that's kind of weird, right? Like, they've made 4 Left Behind movies, and I never felt as scared as when it was like, oh shit, people just pop, turn into dust. Oh fuck, that's horrifying.